Hello and welcome. Welcome back, guys, ladies and gents. What I'm bringing you today, I know it's been a while, ain't it? What I'm bringing you today is another Arma 2 classroom. What brought this kind of catch up and what brought this this particular classroom on was a couple some tension within our unit. You know, should we be four-man teams? Should we be five-man teams for infantry? You know, and I'm gonna kind of go down and we tried them both. And this is really just to help out the community, help out you guys in general, and to kind of give you guys a, you know, my personal opinion, pros and cons of each, and how this will work. Now, what we have is we have two platoons ahead of us, each in different formations that will best aid in the strength. We have Afghan Army, ANA. We are using mods, just so you guys. We're using ANA default fire teams that you put down in Zeus. Default fire teams in Arma are four-man teams. And we're going to slightly go over each position. Firepower, in essence. Maneuverability, and kind of we'll get into the Zeus mobile, and we'll go around in some of the different areas in Altus, and we'll give you firsthand kind of a breakdown and analyze a lot of things. So right off the bat, four-man teams. What is the argument? Why do we need a four-man team? Four-man teams are smaller. In essence, they're smaller. They're more maneuverable. If you have a really small unit, this will give you the more teams. The one issue that we're having right now is, you know, or the one argument is, well, you know, we have enough for two squads of five, but we could have, you know, three squads of four, something like that. You know, if we just pulled those guys, those extra guys out and shoved them, we can make the line longer. The problem with this is, as you can see right here, four guys, they're pretty well spread thin. This is a basic column. Obviously, if you use the default, they don't alternate. So these are in echelons, echelon left, right. You have a command or what would be a platoon setting, command setting, in, or a squad command setting in the middle, and then you would have the rest of the squads and platoons. So basically what we got here is we have two squads, one in the front. We have its squad leader in the back. Kind of just simulate. So imagine that this first team right here, this would be a team. The one behind it would be a team. That's one squad. The squad leader would be in between the two. Then there would be two squads, and then a platoon command, and then two more squads. And then basically that would make the entire platoon. And then the platoons would be side by side with each other, with the company command in the middle. Okay? So to kind of give that. Right here, team lead. My personal opinion and what I teach my guys, if you're a team leader, you lead from the front. All leaders lead from the far front. Doesn't matter if you have a corporal rank on or a major bar. That's kind of what you have to do. This, in essence, with a four-man team, it makes it a little bit challenging. It has its own set of challenges. And we'll go into them in depth quite a bit. So, team lead. Pros of having a four-man team, well, that's not that many more bodies you have to manage. In my personal opinion, it's kind of hitting that easy button. I'll only have three bodies and myself to manage. I don't have to manage anyone else. But on paper, it seems like an easy idea. It seems like you're going to be able to fit in those real tight spots, buildings. A lot of people will argue either for or against. You know, four-man teams are better for mount training or mount operations than you know, out in the open. Out in the open, you can hide better because you're so small. The thing is, you guys are not a special operations team. Our unit currently has a special operations team, and we're not going to get too much into it, but we operate different, and we have different tactics, different rules of engagement, different things, and we use different equipment. And each person is an individual role. Like, it would be different if this team leader was just the team leader, and then you had a medic, and you had a an engineer and a combo sergeant, you'd have everything. That's a whole different formation. We're talking about regular infantry. So the way we have ours set up is we have a 3-1 platoon. We have three rifle squads and one weapon squad, one medic per platoon there with the platoon command, and includes the RO and everything like that. So basically, what is the team? The team are hammers, enemy's nails. They go beat the hell out of the enemy, all right? And who's leading that formation? That is the team leader. So team leader always leads from the front until the engagement happens. Then he kind of takes a step back and commands his troops. Now, another argument is, well, if you have a five-man team, you have one guy that is alone. Well, theoretically speaking, in certain formations, let's say the team leader was like a corporal, everybody else in the formation, the other three guys are privates. Well, you're not going to leave a private out to do what he's going to do. Anybody in the military knows you leave a private to go do something leave him without any orders or any head to the snake. He's going to go do something dumb. It's kind of like giving a monkey a hand grenade. Give the monkey a hand grenade and go get, beer and popcorn, sit back, because eventually that thing's going to explode. That's basically what a private does if he's on his own. So you got to kind of have a head on a snake. Four-man team, you're going to be that team leader is going to be paired with somebody, and it's either one of three people. Either if he's an alpha team, how we have our team set up is each team are identical except for the Bravo. So alpha team would have the team leader, the AR, the grenadier, and a rifleman. Bravo team would have the team leader, the grenadier, the AR, and a DM, in a four-man team setting. So that's all fine and dandy. Team leader with machine gunner. The only problem is as soon as that machine gunner starts going, that team leader's not going to hear anything, especially if you have anything like ACE or anything like that on. Even if you do have earplugs in, that team leader ain't going to hear anything. And you can't just leave the machine gunner alone. You have to have somebody with him, because if he goes down, you got to have somebody to pick that gun back up. Grenadier, a whole different ball game. It's basically a rifleman with a grenade launcher. But again, that's another mass casualty weapon, and you can't have these two that are on my screen. On the right, the machine gunner. On the left is the 203. You can't have them teamed up, because one grenade or one good well-placed round, it's gonna knock both of them out. And that's both of your mass casualty weapons knocked out. So then you have a rifleman. Okay, normally the rifleman and a lot of people have trouble understanding this. Rifleman is not rifleman slash AT. He's not an AT is a whole different ball game. Anti-tank's the guys with the javelins. These guys might be carrying AT-4s, but they're not anti-tank. They're riflemen first. All right, relax. Let's get that cleared. So how would you're probably asking, so how would you team them up? Well, it's hard. Team leader cannot go with the machine gunner. Team leader cannot go with the rifleman. That leaves the grenadier. The only problem is if the grenadier takes a hit, almost guaranteed that team leader is going to take a hit as well. If that and it, and it's kind of if you think of it in a tactical situation, and I'll bring up my map real quick because I like doing this. So let's say that right here is your, I don't know, let's say this is your auto rifleman. This is your rifleman. Initially, this would be your grenadier, this would be your team leader. But as soon as these guys over here start taking contact, that team leader's got to move. When that team leader moves, this guy's got to move with him. So this leaves this whole area exposed. Now you could sit here and be like, well, he's a big boy. That grenadier could sit there. We're talking maybe over to that building. The AR team, machine gunner team is where I am. The grenadier's over at that building. You're never going to know if that guy gets hit. Of course, you're not going to be this far. You're going to be pretty much from, me to the team leader now away. But even then, there could be bushes, there could be boulders, rocks. In a city setting, that's across the street. Or that's a building over. Or that's or if you're trying out the silhouette on a mountain, you have one half of the team on the east side of the mountain, one half of the team on the west side of the mountain. You guys are going. You're not crossing the apex. That's a long distance. So you and we don't leave people behind. So anywhere that team leader moves, his battle buddy hasn't moved. That team leader has the command. That is what he's there for. He's commanding that team, that lower echelon. Period. Fire teams and shit like that. I mean, those are sub elements within, but this is the basic command, okay? Riflemen don't do, if the rifleman and AR, the rifleman don't tell the AR what to do, the AR don't tell the rifleman. They're both privates in that sense, unless you have them ranked higher. But in our unit, it doesn't matter if you're a specialist or a private, you have the same command authority, which is none. Only the corporals, which are actually in a command position. So it's weak. Four-man teams are very weak. So if you look at it that way, then you're going to basically be clumped together. And anybody knows clumping together is very bad because as soon as one grenade hits or incoming hits or they step on one steps on an IED, the entire team's wiped. Speaking strictly casualty-wise, what we do is the positive rule. Basically, as long as you are above 75%, above 75%, not at 75, above 75% strength, you are still combat effective. If this four-man team, obviously, let's break this down, 100 divided by 4, this is 25. If one guy dies, you're at 75. You're no longer combat effective. Period. It doesn't matter if it's a rifleman that goes down. That team leader is not a fighter. He's a fighter second. He's a leader first. He needs to lead because that squad leader might be a couple hundred meters behind him, or he might be assisting another squad or the other team. Or he might be with that maneuver element. He might be doing something. He might be wounded. And that platoon leader needs that information. Who are you in contact? So he doesn't have time to sit there and I know you can sit there and say, well, it's push a button and aim and shoot. Well, the thing is, if you're sitting here trying to shoot, talk to your guys, and talk over the radio at the same time, one of those is going to fail. Either you're going to suck at shooting, you're going to suck at telling your guys something, or you're going to miss information to send up. So it's easier. Tell the guys what to do. Do that. And then you pull up your weapon. And normally, you just load tracer rounds. Right here, I want machine gunner, you shoot at this. And that's the only one. So if I wanted to shoot, I'd be like, hey, machine gunner, shoot here. He'd see the tracers, he'd start laying down fire. Grenadier, here's the target I want you to hit. Then he would pop a grenade. Bam. Done. Okay? There's different ways to do that. So, four-man teams is very weak. We've been able to see that if you're in a four-man team, two four-man teams can take on roughly about a squad size element. It's roughly anywhere from about 10 to 11 guys, depending on which AI you spawn in or how strong you make them. But it really depends on their augmentation. Insurgents, very, very easy. Four-man teams can handle insurgents. Conventional forces, CSAT, Russian, AAF, things like that, they can't. Pretty much anything with body armor. They just don't have the meat behind them. In every engagement I've been able to see, at least one person gets hit. And I'm not talking about, hitting the arm and he's just in pain and he's bleeding. I'm talking about hit where he's knocked out for, 2-3 seconds, a minute, 20 minutes. He's knocked out. Normally a chest shot, a direct chest shot, or a headshot. And with these AI, they're pretty good. If you have them on a higher difficulty, they're pretty good. The last op we did, the SF team actually engaged a squad. It had a designated marksman. The AI actually pulled out binos, scoped us in, and before we could actually pick up and move to set to cover, the first shot rang. 3 seconds after the first shot rang, I was hit in the head while moving. I was dragged to safety, and about 4 seconds after, I was dragged to safety. I lost one guy, and then about 2 seconds after that, lost another guy. All headshots. So depending on how hard the AI is as well, and what their augmentation are, what their weapons are. Most of the time, if you're dealing with CSAT, you're going to have a little bit higher power weapon. So if it hits you, it's going to hurt. It's going to pack a punch. So in essence, one casualty in a team, that team is no longer ineffective. Because in essence, let's say this machine gunner goes down, that team leader's got to go over, report it up. Hey, I got a guy down. Can I get the medic up here? He starts initiating, tourniquet, bandage, morphine, tourniquet, 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 bandage, bandage, bandage. Whatever he's gonna do, whatever his process, your guys' process is, because the medics aren't here. These guys only have like first aid capability. They don't have stitching. They don't have packing. They can't give IVs, anything like that. So they got need to stop the bleeding, just like in real life, is what we're trying to simulate here. So, in essence, as that machine gunner went down, you just lost that team leader too, because he's now focusing as much of his attention on that guy as possible. Now it's a double-edged sword. You can sit here and be like, "Well, you just said scaling him that he's a team leader. He needs to focus on commanding." All right, and in that sense, you got to pull a rifleman or a grenadier to go aid that man while you're still in command. That only leaves two guys out. One of them's either commanding, or you have really weak flanks. You're not combat effective. Literally, you can't do anything because as soon as you go up against something, which the smallest element is a sentry, if you go up against a sentry with three guys, nah, you might get the surprise on them. But if they get the jump on you, or they're able to, you shoot and you miss, and they're able to get a couple shots off, as soon as they hit somebody, you're toast. They just equal the odds. Normally, it's 3-to-1 odds. We've been fighting in our unit opposite of that. We've been fighting against 3-to-1 odds. But all, again, it also depends on the augmentation. Are they mechanized? Are they armored? Urban settings, open terrain, sand. Are you out in the middle of this, which you shouldn't? You should definitely be in cover over in Egypt somewhere. But, the four-man team, it has its merits. So pros and cons. Pros: small. A little bit easier to maneuver. You can hide concealments very well. You can easily and comfortably fit into a building, front door, back door, one upstairs, and the team leader rotating in between the three. It makes units stretch. You can basically stretch it out. And it gives It does kind of limit firepower. In the essence, if an alpha team, if you have it set up kind of like what we do, the alpha team and a five-man team would have an extra rifleman. That'd be an extra AT4 and an extra rifle, which rifles are better than MGs in a sense that point accuracy is better than area of effect. So if you range it like that, you can have a machine gunner all day and he could just spray and pray, as most people say, but I can have one rifleman with an ACOG just dome that guy, and then guess what? You're toast. So it does kind of limit your firepower in that essence, but then it does make you specialize more. You can specialize specific equipment. You can have alpha team as purely assault. So they would have a little bit more of like the hand grenades, a little bit more ammo, a little bit more of the assault stuff. Bravo team could have a little bit more ammo as well, but heavier on medical supplies because they would be the base. Basically, they'd be laying down the fire, the assault ultimate element goes through, boom, and then the Bravo team assaults through and picks up any casualties. You could do something like that. The thing is if any of those teams get isolated, or if you're in a line formation, they're direct left and right of each other, and they get hit in the center, and they get split, they're going to be weaker. Even though they're on both sides, they're still weaker. Okay. Moving over here, moving on. So this is the four-man team, four-man teams, right? Let's move over here to my handy-dandy U.S. Army. This is what we currently run in our units. We just changed. We tested out the four-man team. It was just too weak. We couldn't really do it. And there's still people that argue the same. But five-man. What does this give you? Well, team leader, again, always leads from the front in our unit. That's kind of how it goes. You have an AR grenadier, boom, you see them on your flanks. You have two riflemen peeled out on the far, and you can rotate those. Sometimes I know some, depending on, how you run, how you were taught. I was always taught the LMG and the grenadier were on the far out, and the two riflemen were in, and then you had the team leader. Some people flipped them. It doesn't really matter. They're just on opposite sides, right? So that being said, this one, a little bit more meatier. It's set up perfect. You have the riflemen on the right with the AR. You have a rifleman on the left with the grenadier. Those are battle buddy teams. Team leader can move in between. So literally, you can have one team, you know, 20 meters to the left of the team leader, one team 20 meters to the right. Team leader can move in between. They still have two rifles aiming. You don't have to pull anybody. When the team leader moves, he doesn't have anybody moving with him. It's just keeping tabs. You know, if let's say there's 40 meters between each fire team, or each battle buddy team, he could sit there and be like, "All right, AR, I'm on my way to you. Be there in 3-4 seconds." And then, you know, 20 seconds later, the AR is like, "Hey, boss, where you at?" And then they know, okay, well, he got down somewhere between then. It should be somewhat visual, but like I said, depending on terrain and things like that. What this brings you is a little bit more meatier. Instead of taking one casualty and pretty much being combat ineffective, now you can sit here and argue all day. Three guys can do what six AI can do, or whatever you want. Eventually, you're going to run up against an AI that has a drop on you, and he's really, really good because he sat there and shot at you for about the past hour and a half, and you haven't seen him. And then all of a sudden, you're three guys. He takes two rounds, drops two of you, and the last guy doesn't know what he's doing because he's freaking Pee Wee Herman sitting over here in the bush, you know, looking at butterflies, and then he gets domed, and your entire squad's wiped, or team's wiped. Basically, what this does is you have to get two casualties. Two casualties, and you're still moderately combat effective. You're not combat effective because you're underneath the 75% rule, but you're moderately beefy. You can still, you either have two riflemen and an AR, two riflemen and a grenadier, a team leader, a rifleman and a grenadier, a team leader, a rifleman and an AR, team leader and two riflemen, any combination of those. So in essence, you can actually have two guys watch, team leader's doing the medical, and you know everything else is somewhat. You have more play. Firepower, the rifleman can carry two AT4s for an alpha team. Like I got right here, this would be considered our standard alpha team for our unit. The two riflemen that are on these wings, on the outside of these wings, they would have AT4s. They have the choice. It's that team leader's. This is a typical Bravo team that we have. Team leader in the front. You have an AR. Then you have a rifleman, M4. Then you have a grenadier, and you have your DM. Now, this is the specialty. All right, Bravo, Alpha Bravo teams. This is how I have them set up. Alpha Assault, Bravo is base of fire. See how that kind of works? AB, Alpha Bravo, base assault. Makes it easier for me. So what this essentially does is this Bravo team can line up online. They have the full firepower that that Alpha team has. The only difference is they have a DM. The DM is able to pick off specific targets. So if there's a, you know, let's say we're attacking that mountain or that building right there, that structure, and there's a guy in the that they just can't get. They can't shoot 203s, it's out of range or something like that. This gives that good medium to long range capability for this unit to actually perform. It's a really good implementation, and every one of our rifle squads have them. We have three. And that assault element can basically, it has that meteor. It can really, really start assaulting through. Five guns better than four. I mean, how many would you have in your gunfight? Would you say, no, I don't need this extra rifle. I'll only deal with four in a gunfight, no matter what. Are you going to push that rifle away, or are you going to pull it in? We choose to pull it in. So in that retrospect, what are the pro cons of this? Pros. Well, and we kind of went into the pros and not too much into the cons of the other one, because I think cons were pretty well self-explanatory. You know, smaller unit, you're going to take more casualties. I harped on that. The pros of this one, the five-man, you're a little bit meatier. You have an extra rifle. You have an extra AT4. You have extra ammo magazines. You have extra medical supplies. That individual's carrying a lot of equipment. You know, it's not only carrying a rifle. He's carrying grenades, ammo, medical supplies, an extra radio in case one of yours glitches out. He's carrying nods. He's carrying an extra optic, something like that. So it's a little bit more firepower, depending on how good your riflemen are, how good they are with AT4s, things like that. Also depends on what enemy you're up against. It also gives the command, it gives pressure off of that team leader. Instead of that team leader in the four-man team, excuse me, whenever he had to move, that rifleman or someone had to move with him, that grenadier had to move with him, or else he would basically have one guy on the left flank or right flank and two guys on the opposite. This guy can have two and two, and he can move in between. That gives a battle buddy team, because if one guy gets hit, like I said, the four-man team, if he leaves him there, that guy gets hit. He's never going to know he's hit until he goes back. By the time he goes back, he could have lost too much blood, and he's done. By the time the med gets there, he's lost. He's dead, because of seconds, minutes. Maybe that team leader goes over there and he gets pinned down, and that guy's wounded, and he's yelling over the radio, "I need help! I need help! I need help!" Somebody gets up, and then that creates one of those casualty flows. You want to avoid that. So that way, if in a five-man team, if one guy gets hit, he's always going to have someone there. The only one that's not is going to be the team leader, but he should be moving in between. He should be communicating with both his AR and his grenadier. Of course, his rifleman as well, but those are the two primaries. He needs to be telling where those two need to start putting down their effective fire. Grenadiers don't just fire everything, fire at the first thing they shoot. The team leader has to tell him where to shoot. Okay, that way he can put. It doesn't make sense to have a rifleman, both riflemen, a grenadier lobbing grenades, an AR shooting at one guy to the right, and you have five guys on the left. Maybe have the grenadier and one of the riflemen start shooting at the guys on the left, AR and a rifleman shooting at the guys on the right, and then whenever that guy on the right's down, all fire started shifting to the left. Split that up. So it does give a little bit of pressure off. Does give him a little bit more play. He can do a 360. I'm gonna run over here to this command element. They're basically in a diamond formation. This is standard stock for what we would consider in SF as our 360, our 360 update formation. Basically, if we get an update halfway through or a follow-on order, something like that, or a frago, we bring it in close. They take a knee, and they're all in earshot. So basically, they can do the same thing. Again, we're not trying to compare and contrast SF with everybody else, but basically, I would be the team leader. These guys would be my minions, 360 around me, except for him. He's being retarded. And there you go. It gives a little bit better. Instead of basically, you're looking at like an arrowhead. Mount. This is where the five-man team gets a lot of harp. They get harped on. They get smashed. They get pushed down. People don't like it. It's too many people in a building. And we're gonna go into Zeus real quick. And we're going to fly, baby, fly. So this would be a standard echelon. You would have these sorts. You could be strong side left. All you do is peel this guy and put him over here. Strong side left. Again, strong side right. Basically, what you're doing is you're moving the rifleman. The grenadier and AR stay the same. And then you alternate. So if this is strong side left, this rifleman's over here. This one, what second team would be strong side right. That guy would be there. Third, fourth, things like that. And in the squad, you would basically the team the squad command would be right here. So if they got engaged, what would happen? Let's go ahead and simulate something real quick. Okay, contact front, contact front. Of course, we're gonna move. Nope, not you. You go back to where you're laying. Okay, Bravo element, Alpha element, squad command. Of course, squad command is only going to be a squad leader. But then what will happen is this one will start assaulting, base of fire. This one will set for your bounding movements. Boom, boom. Under the same pretenses, line them up. Alpha, Bravo. you're really limited. You don't have a rifleman on Bravo team, so he doesn't have you don't have that excess AT4. Wait until these guys decide to do whatever the hell they're wanting to do. There we go. I mean, you take it from yourself. I mean, who do you think would win? Even though they're AAF or ANA and U.S. Army, it doesn't matter. By the numbers, who do you think would win, squad to squad? If they had both had cover, if they were in urban terrain, they both knew exactly where each other were, they had the same fire, they both opened up the same time, they had the exact same amount of cover, who would come out? And I can probably guarantee you, yeah, this squad's going to be easier to see, but it's that it has that extra guy, that one gun, or two guns per squad, that one gun per team can really make a difference. Over here, here's the argument. So, and I think this is where it really comes into a problem with the five man. This is where a five man gets flak. So let's say you're clearing this small area, okay? As the five man comes in, I think what's happening, I haven't been able to prove it is with our squad, but they try to shove five guys in this room. It could work in essence. Yes, it very well could. You have an AR here, you have your grenadier here, you have a rifleman here, you have a rifleman covering the door, and your team leader moving in between. There you go. But they're like, here's a better example. They're trying to fit five guys in this little hut. There's only three win there's one window and two doors. So you have one guy that's basically in the way. But I haven't had that problem with a five-man team because I spread my guys out. So in this one, you have one main entrance that has to have somebody on it. Somebody has to be watching that entrance. Then you have two windows, so you could have this window, the door closed, guy peeled over here, chilling. You could have an AR here. You go in the other room. You got another half-open window, so you don't really need somebody at this window. But this window doesn't see anything. Maybe get an angle right here, and then team leader can move in between. That's enough space. Again, same building here. Here's another perfect one. One, two entrances. So there's two of your guys. Could be a rifleman, could be a grenadier, AR, whatever. Then you have one window, two windows, and a balcony. So if you're aiming in this, if your formation is moving this direction, I don't, if you're moving down the road and you cleared this would be perfect. Because now you have an AR, your AR, you have your team leader scouting, you have a rifleman, and then you have your grenadier and your other rifleman. There's all the entrances. This, the same way. I mean, you have two entrances, team leader moves in between, and then you have two windows. So there's your 360. I mean, in essence, team leader would be looking, north, south, east, west, double checking. But those are some of that's the first group of houses. Let's go over here to this town. Let's really look at some of the different houses. Sorry a little bit about the lag. Yeah, it's being weird. So some of the most common buildings in Arma. Let's go ahead and close these. These are some of the most common ones that you'll see. These ones, especially with this little outhouse. Now, people lose their fucking mind. I ain't gonna lie. People lose their damn mind whenever they get into this. They enter the door and it's too overwhelming. And they look at, they're sitting there with a tape measure looking at foot space. Where's I can tell you right now, a guy laying on the ground takes up more space than a guy standing up. And chances are, if you're laying on the ground, you're pinned down inside there. That means somebody is physically shooting a machine gun through the window, and you can't get up. The thing is, there's multiple windows. So a four-man team, if four-man team came in here, you have one in the door. One at the door. That's already two. Then you have one upstairs. The thing is the doors should not be open. You close the doors unless you're clearing. You go in, you clear, and you're going right back up the same way. A case-by-case scenario, if you're actually in contact, that is where you're going to take cover. You're going cover to cover. If you're just patrolling, you haven't taken contact yet, you're moving through, you might have two fire teams clearing buildings along your route ahead as scouts. They're basically just going to walk in, clear, come back out. But if you're actually taking contact from down the road and you're going into this, you're going to have a 360 up. You're going to need a 360. You're going to have these doors closed. If you don't have the doors closed, chances are there's a 203 waiting or an RPG waiting just coming right on through it and say hello, and give you a big fat kiss. Up here, these buildings, normally it's a hit and miss. Some of these windows will be open, some of them will be closed. But here's the thing, you have two of your four guys downstairs covering closed doors. You have one, that leaves one guy and a team leader to basically look around. They're doing a lot of movement. They're not going to sit there and look. If they're sitting there and looking, there's a corner, there's an angle, there's something that is not seen. So let's say that we are, we look at these, we come in, okay, well these two windows are shut. We can't really see anything through there. This one's kind of half-assed. We can only see a certain angle. This one's open. This one's, okay, and this one's okay. So the team leader basically has a walk through here. As soon as he takes eyes off of a section, so let's say he goes right here, and he's trying to get a degree. He can't see anything over here to his left, but he comes over here. Guess what? He can see a little bit more, but he still can't see stuff way over to his left. He can get right here. See, there's that broken down building. Let's see if we can't get in. If I try, there's the other side of the broken down building. But see, he can't see anything. If you have that extra guy, that extra guy could be right here. I mean, it's not anything great. It's still giving you that look of right here. You can early warn this guy, hey, someone's coming up, or hey, somebody could be looking here and tell these guys. You know what I'm saying? These buildings, pain in the ass. Most of them have open windows, like all around, like as open as you could possibly get it. This one's another one. You have to have someone watching this door. You have to have someone watching this door. The only problem is look at the corridor between these doors. If a guy sits here, he's in the way. That team leader can't get past him, and if that team leader's walking this way, that door opens and it's an enemy, that team leader's gonna pass right in front of that guy. The guy can't be right here because as soon as that door opens, he's right in his face. He needs to put distance. If he goes right over here, he's still that his members are in it, in that his team leader or his members are going to be in that crossfire. So the best I've seen is to have him set about right in here. What'll happen is team leader will normally station somebody in this back room because it's the dead center. Dead center of the building, you look out it, you can pretty much see at the same angles. Then you would have somebody watching out here, either here or here. You have two guys, and then your team leader would basically just move in between. He'd be scanning this side. Okay? He'd be basically looking at this side. He'd walk back through over here. He'd check this window. Okay? Does that make a little bit of sense? I hope. Let's find some other buildings here. Do 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 do. Comp. Oh, this one here. Yeah, this is all right. And then we'll do compounds. This one. There's no doors. I hate to say it. So you want at least a bulk of your troops low. A lot of team leaders, a lot of squad leaders, a lot of command echelons, a lot of units don't actually do this. They will put as many of their guys on the top as they can because, height. If they have four guys on top, that's four cardinal directions, and they're at the highest point. The problem is you have all four guys. What we've run into is if you have any kind of an AT gun, they're normally gonna load HE and just halo one right through your freaking face. And as soon as they hit something, even if they were to hit this pillar right here, it's still gonna knock everybody out. Still gonna knock the guys down here out. Reduction in silhouettes. Obviously don't have anybody up here. But what we normally do is we would have a for this particular one, nobody's getting through right here, okay? So you would have somebody, this would be the best area to defend from. So you would have one guy here facing out. You'd have one guy over here facing out. I mean, you can have them in here if they don't have this concrete pillar. You can have them right here facing this direction. And then this guy would basically just kind of like float. And what I mean by float is there's no active cover. I mean, he can go over here and lay down on this side of the wall and aim that way, but what happens if he takes hits from this compound over here? It's not really that good. Basically, what he's going to do is he's going to take a knee, and he's going to kind of like just peer out, or he's going to lay down right here, and he's going to kind of just keep an eye out here to make sure nothing's coming. Meanwhile, the Grenadier, traditionally it's the Grenadier and the team leader will be up on top, because if that team leader does see, you know, hey, there's four guys right here, he can lob a grenade over there, boom, done. Whereas if you have the AR or rifleman, you're gonna sit there and shoot. Chances are you're gonna get one. The rest of them are gonna lay down. They're gonna move. They're gonna get a position. They're gonna start firing back. They're gonna radio up. One grenade knocks them all out. Plus, the Grenadier, how we have our echelon of command is if the team leader goes down, that Grenadier is the team leader. Then it will be the rifleman and the AR. The AR is just it's just too busy. It's just too much. So that's how we would normally set up a five-man team. A four-man team in the same would be very difficult. The three guys would still be in the bottom, it'd just be one on top. And if he needed a Grenadier, the Grenadier would have to come up. He'd have to show him, then go down, cover the Grenadier spot. Grenadier would take him out. He'd come back up. Grenadier would go back down. It's just a lot of moving parts that you don't really need. It's a lot. It's really a lot of excess movement. So here is a small compound. Four-man team wise, normally you want eyes out. This being a walled-in area. You don't really have to put anyone on a door. You have to put someone on this door. You have to put someone on the gate. You have to put someone in here looking. And that really leaves your team leader going, basically, okay, is this door good? Is this door good? Is this door good? Basically, he's checking the locks on the doors instead of actually looking out and reporting. With a five-man, what can happen is you can have one float. You can actually have guys that you can have one that basically just patrols right outside, to give you kind of that early warning system. You can have your casualty collection point in here with one of your riflemen, or you can have a CCP or something, or your CCP is your casualty collection point. You can have a CP, command post area, anything like that. You can have one rifleman over here, and if they start taking contact from this direction, that rifleman peels out, boom, he's in here, and now you're inside of a compound. Four man. Like I said, three of your four are going to be watching doors. And like I said, doors and gates must be closed. Why? You're probably asking, well, why? Why, Skahan? Why would we need to close the doors? As I said, RPG goes through it. If it hits a door, less shrapnel is going to go through it. You're still going to get that explosion, that concussion, that explosive hit. It'll probably knock you out and might crack some bones, maybe get a couple hot lacerations, but you're not going to get that full brunt of the shrapnel as well. Shrapnel is what's going to really fuck you guys up, especially if you have ace and stuff like that. Shrapnel is the worst because it's a 50-50 shot. Some guys, I've been blown up once and never had a scratch on me. I've been blown up one time with a hand grenade and had like 60 cuts. It is ridiculous. So, in that essence, it also puts a barrier. Whenever that round hits the door, it can go through it, but it can't. It does have a chance of deflecting. So you could be standing right behind the door, and it hits the door right where your head would be, and it could deflect up just enough to go over the top of your head, or just enough to hit body armor or your helmet or something like that, where it won't do that much damage. Windows do the same. They will deflect until they get broken. Gates are the same way. Most of these gates that you see right here, they're steel. They're a little bit harder to penetrate through. 7.62 can go through them like cheesecake. Make sure you note the weapons of your enemies as well. That should be an intel officer's deal. Your S2, but that's basically what happens. Okay. Let's go out here and look for another unique building. Oh, perfect. Here, these warehouses. Everybody loves these damn warehouses for some reason. Warehouses are really, it's a hit and miss. Not counting these sheds. One person, two people can clear a shed. You can take cover in a shed. a wooden shove, four people could fit comfortably in a shed. You have two, basically one watching the main door, two watching two windows, and the guy walking in between. The only problem is the shed is probably the weakest thing you could possibly get in. But we're not talking about the shed. Let's talk about this warehouse. So we have, in essence, if you look at it, we have one, two, three, four, five, six, seven doors. Seven doors with four po with any kind of combinations of opening. Okay. Worst case scenario, the big door's open. The bigger the opening, the more shit can come through it. The smaller the opening, the more pinpoint. Okay. It's kind of like I can't remember what movie it was. Aim small, miss small. It's kind of one of those. You open the doors and you're basically opening up, you know, what's easier to shoot through? A straw? Can you shoot through an edge of a straw? Or can you shoot through an opening of a cup? What's going to be easier for you to shoot through? It's basically the same. It's going to give you more cover. So with this, I would definitely have one guy watching each of the three doors. And as I said, seven, because each of these have a combination. There's two main doors and one smaller door, so that's three doors. I would not have him behind it. I would have him augmented about right here. If the door opens, this still gives him enough to start firing in that general direction or direction. If the big doors open, he can actually maneuver forward. The reason you don't want him directly behind it, again, doors open, he's got to move sideways, forward, sideways. It really puts him in a bad spot, especially if this one opens. See, if I'm sitting right here, this door opens. You know, I move forward again. I'm still somewhat exposed, but I'm limited. They have to come at a certain angle. But I'm still able to kind of keep an angle on this. So if this door opens, I still got it. All right. With a five-man team, you're going to be able to cover all three and then have a float in between and your team leader in between. So that float can actually look through this window. He can primary this window. Your float could actually walk outside. Give you kind of a general once over, see what's out there. You can station your float anywhere out here. Gives you a lot more stuff to work with a five-man team than a four-man team. You're a lot more versatile. Okay. Just to wrap this up, because I think we kind of saturated the idea. It's case by case situation. And it's what you guys have available. Four-man fire teams, again, they're down one rifle, one possible AT4. You know, you could sit here and say, well, yeah, you might not have a rifleman with an AT4, but you could have the grenadier take an AT4. Yeah, but I mean, again, it's just like saying, okay, you're an AR. You have to carry all these boxes of ammo. Here's an AT4, to add to it. Don't worry, you'll be fine. Just because you have the AT4 on someone, excuse me, doesn't mean it's of use. And a lot of people don't understand that technology, the terminology, that effectiveness, everything in between. The AR, as soon as the AR stops firing, that is a huge hit. That is a tremendous amount of firepower, a tremendous amount of sustaining fire that you just lost. So if he's sitting here fumble-assing around with an AT4, if anybody's ever, you know, sat there, got an AT4 ready, you're going to have to stand up and expose yourself to fire it. Okay? With Ace, if something's behind you, like a wall or a rock or a tree, the back glass is going to hit that and come back and hit him and knock him out. Okay? Or he's going to knock out the team leader or knock out the grenadier. Or he's going to knock out the rifleman or knock out somebody behind him. Or maybe he's cleared, he shoots, bam, and the guy, it hits, it's close, and shrapnel hits him in the head. Or the tank turns, fires at him. Either way, you know, under perfect circumstances, everybody loves to hit me with the perk. Well, he can hit it, and then he pulls his gun up, and he can start doing infantry. Well, what happens if the infantry's on the right, this tank's on the left, and, you know, you're taking that weapon that would be a huge, you know, shift in momentum, and instead of pulling that rifleman and having him go deal with it, you lose a rifleman. You still got the team leader. He's got his rifle. You lose that AR, someone's gonna have to pick up that AR. And the thing is you don't want a rifleman to go do it, per se, because then he's gonna dump his rifle, he's gonna pick up that, he's gonna have to dump all of his ammo, all of his excess ammo. Unless, of course, he's using something like 5.56, which he should. All that's compatible, but he's gonna still have to dump some of his ammo, which takes time to pick up those belts. Third round mags go through a 249 like Drano through a human being. I mean, it just 30 rounds is nothing, especially if he starts really putting down the cyclic. So the AR is really the last man under the echelon. Team lead, grenadier, rifleman, depending on rank and experience, and then AR. It's nothing against the AR. The AR does have a big role. He just needs to focus on doing that. So throwing him with an AT4 because you want to have a four-man team isn't the answer. Throwing the AT4 on the Grenadier, it's the same thing. It's weight, unless you have weight turned off, which that would be dumb because then your military simulation or realism is nothing. We adapt it. Again, do you really want that guy with the Grenadier? Because if he goes down again, that's something that you could use. Maybe you're in really thick terrain. Maybe these guys are in the woods or behind trees. You don't know where they are. You're just gonna lob a grenade, hopefully get them wounded or get them to move, or to shift. Because the AI in this, if they are really good, if they're hitting you and you're not hitting them or hitting anywhere near them, in their morale system or however the computing system works, they will stay there and continue to fire. I've been shot by the same sniper like 7 times and he stayed in the same place. The reason was we couldn't find out where he was. It wasn't until we figured out fire a grenade and it hits relatively in that general area, he will move. He will shift because he doesn't want to get hit. He'll move to cover. And that'll give you some leeway. So you don't really want to lose him. And in the same sense, it's more weight. I mean, you're gonna take a hit either way. DM ain't gonna have it. Chances are DM is gonna use somewhere around a 7.62 caliber weapon. It's a heavier round. He's gonna have to carry the same amount of magazines as everybody else, but they're heavier. So you don't really want to do that. So it's just easier. Chuck in their extra rifleman for the Bravo. Chuck in the extra rifleman for the Alpha, and that'll give you a total of 3 anti-tank rockets, AT4s instead of initially one per squad, which is completely insane. And kind of give you that visual effect, of kind of what I'm talking about here. We have one rifleman right here with an AT4, whereas this guy and this guy would both be an AT4, be possible to have an AT4, and this guy over here would have an AT4. Where'd he go? Right here. So you would have three versus here's your two squads. If you have, this rifleman over here as a DM, this is the only AT4 you got. So you make the call. What kind of firepower do you want? If you're doing more insurgent style, maybe you don't need the AT4. Yeah, shrink it down, go into four-man teams. There you go. We do a mixture of insurgency and conventional forces. And it's four-man team just isn't meaty enough. Also, five-man, if you look at it, a four-man team in a Humvee, you have the driver, the TC, and the two packs in the back. Or you have one pack in the back and one grenadier. Or one, not grenadier, gunner. Whereas the five-man, you just filled up a gun truck. And you're probably like, well, what happens if the gun truck gets hit with an AT4 or a rocket and it blows up? You get 5 casualties. Well, I mean, there's nothing you can do about it. You're sitting here, basing casualties off of 5 casualties or 4 casualties. In essence, you still lost a team. So that statement doesn't really have a lot of authority or a lot of weight. To pull that, you would need 2 full squads to make a full team for a third squad, if you had a went to a 5 to a 4. If you're going from a 4 to a 5, you would need 3 squads to fill up, basically 2 squads, or 2 squads to fill up 1 squad, and you would still have remnants of a team left over. Anyway, guys, just to really kind of finish up playing, make sure everything's all hunky-dory and everybody kind of understands how this works. And yes, we've been talking long enough that my squad that was assigned over here in the main airfield has actually ran all the way here. It's amazing. Players won't run 10 feet. These guys ran 5 kilometers. Dedication at the max for AI. But really, just to wrap it up and give you guys kind of put a bow on it, pretty like. Neither one of these, the 5 or 4 man team, are necessarily one's not better than the other. 4 man team, you take one casualty, you're combat ineffective. 5 man team, you take one casualty, you're still perfectly combat effective. Take two. It depends, I guess. You'd be down to 60%, whereas in the 4 man team, you take one casualty, you'd be at 75. But if you take two casualties in a 5 man, two casualties in a 4 man, 60% strength, 50% strength. I mean, you'd be the judge. You can sit here and slice it either way you want. Hands down, already know 4 man team is going to be easier to maneuver. It's going to be easier to fit in all the little bitty tiny buildings. You can fit everybody comfortably into the porta potty, and still do your business. But in my personal opinion, I believe that 4 man team really restricts that team leader. It really puts a lot of pressure on that team leader because now he has to fight. He has to focus on fighting. He has to focus on doing that instead of team lead. And I know some of you are going to be critical and be like, "Well, he should be able to do this and do that and do this." I can tell you right now, team leads are, these are guys. Initially, team leads are not sergeants. They're not squad leaders. These guys are just getting their teeth cut, just getting their feet wet, dipping their toe in the water, making sure this is something they want to do. Squad leads, they're doing it. They're leading. They're out there fighting their squads. They're radioing up ace reports and sit reps and things like that. Contact 20 meters north northwest, 30 degrees of my current position. Blah 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 blah, rattling off how many guys they got. That all comes from the team lead. The thing is if that team leader is concentrating on fighting instead of commanding, it's one or the other. Either he's going to command or he's going to fight. If you're going to have a team lead that commands, let him command. If you're going to have a team lead that fights, then don't even have a team lead. Just have a team, two teams with no team leads, and just have a squad lead. That's it, and be done with it. And essentially, I mean, if you really want to break it down to roles, that squad lead would be the team leads, and then that platoon echelon would be the squad leads, and that company echelon would be the platoon, and the battalion would be the company, and everybody would be all hunky-dory. You wouldn't have any responsibility. We don't do that. We give the way we have ours. We give that responsibility for our team leads. You're initially going to be, you're working as a team lead. You're a rifleman or an AR or grenadier. You're now a team lead. You're working to be a squad lead. Squad leads are working to be platoon commands. Platoon commands are working to be company commands. Companies are working to be battalion, and things like that. So it really does give that person, let them cut their teeth, give them some reins, let them go. But mentor them. Don't just, throw them the team lead gear and throw them into combat and be like, "Here you go, learn." You got to teach them something, teach them a little bit of things or two. Let them see how, the squads and platoons command. It kind of gives them a little bit of that spark. You're basically making that spark in them. See what they turn into. And I think they're going to be able to do a lot easier with 5 man instead of 4 man. That's my personal opinion. Over our assessment, what we've been able to see is casualties go up. You can have one guy that's Rambo, but this is Arma, gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen. I hate to say it, this is Arma. And Arma has one thing that it is very good at, and if you're an individual, you will more than likely die. You want to play Call of Duty, go play Call of Duty. Don't bring Call of Duty here. It ain't gonna work with the game mechanics. From what we've tested and what we've seen in our ops, of course, this is how we set up our ops. We're up against conventional force. They have armor, they have mechanized, they have aviation support, they have indirect support, they have insurgent style support. So IEDs, VBIDs, traps, booby traps, mines. They have snipers, they have forward observers, they have quick reaction forces. They have armor mechanized, like I said. They have seaborne aviation. They can call in laser-guided missiles. They have drones. We basically throw everything in the kitchen sink at our guys, and so far they've been able to perform. We give them that leeway. So I hope you guys enjoyed it. I hope you guys learned. Leave some comments. What do you guys think? Do you think the four-man team would be better than the five-man team, or do you believe the five-man team is better than a four-man team? Or do you believe that maybe it shouldn't have team leads, you should just have a squad lead with two teams, and then he just maneuvers the two teams and effectively acts like a team lead for both of them? Or is that too much? What is your guys' opinions? What do you guys think? Thank you guys for showing up. Thank you guys for watching, hanging through it, listening to kind of me pitch this. I'm going to try to do as many of these tutorials as I can. I know I said that before. School and stuff, work's been getting in the way. But what we got is I'm seeing a lot of issues coming in the Arma community, the Milsim community, and I'm trying to address them as best I can. And I hope you guys enjoy it. I will be coming out with some of you have asked out there, and I will let you guys know whenever I get it done. I will be having something kind of an overview of SF and how SF has operated the best in Arma 3 and in Milsim units, and how to kind of contain them. Did a couple videos back, did one of them, and well, that mentioned SF, and we'll go over that. I'll have that out. But this kind of gives you a basic element set of an infantry division. Now, infantry companies, one thing I want to disclose, infantry companies are not the same as mechanized. Do not put five tanks. Don't put five tanks together. Four is fine. Three is fine. Five is a bit much. Okay? Whenever you're dealing with vehicles or aviation assets, those are total different formations. Special operations, those are total different formations, except for Rangers, MARSOC, some of those bigger company-sized or formations that you're looking at. SF ODA teams, ODB teams, ODC, all those, you can really, this excludes them because they're team-based, they're not company-based. And just a little bit more information to add on. A squad can do a movement to contact. A team can't do movement to contact. A team can do reconnaissance, they can do an ambush, but they cannot do a movement to contact alone. The squad has to be there, preferably more squads than one, because obviously you're going to want a big chunk of your reinforcements. But teams are very limited. They're very small. Reconnaissance, long range, short range, medium range, advanced reconnaissance, advanced or simplistic reconnaissance. Basically, what those two are is advanced is okay. We want you to go to this village and sneak in, talk to some civilians, gather some intel, give us basically they're sitting there for XYZ amount of time. Whereas the simplistic is they're going to go out and do kind of a circle 360 about 200 meters, 300 meters out, see what's around you and come back. That's it. They're just going out, check out what's out there and come back. You're going to look at trees and butterflies and stuff, come back. Whereas advanced, you're going to go out there and you're actually going to dig around in somebody's trash can and try to find something. See, what's there. Is there an IED down the road, something like that. Fire teams can, or yeah, fire teams can do that. Either five or four, doesn't really matter. Again, If you're sending that one team out to do an ambush, the reason you would send a team out to do an ambush is because initially they would have, I mean, from the book, and like I said, put that in quotation marks, from the book, they would have the element of surprise. Four-man team, they're going to have one. If it's an assault squad, they're going to have one AT-4. If it is a base team, they're not going to have an AT-4. They're going to have a DM. If you have five man, you got two AT-4s and Alpha and one AT-4 and Bravo. So it really depends on the mission, and what you're trying to accomplish, what your how your unit is organized and things like that. So Rangers could use something similar to a five or four man team. MARSOC 5 or 4, basic infantry, light infantry, mechanized, motorized, airborne, air assault, they can use the 5 or 4. We're talking specifically infantry here. Anyway, not going to take up any more of your time. Thank you guys for showing up. Like, subscribe, leave a comment. Let me know what's going on. Let me know if you guys want to see anything else. And I'll try to be getting out more of these videos for you guys so you guys can kind of see, so I can explain some things that may be a little bit difficult for some units, some formations, some buddies, to really grasp. You know, should we be in a four man or a five man? You know, this, that, six man. Is it better to go, you know, four and a two, have a two man sniper team, something like that? You could do something like that. It's under the concept, but you have to know the main things you need to know is you need to know your enemy, you need to know the terrain, you need to know what you have and what capabilities you're going to be able to go up against. Do you have one team, two teams, five man team, or five man per team, four man per team? You have two squads, you have already in the background. What do you got? And it's really up to you to list those down and then see what formation is going to be able to help you the best. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, thank you. Go forth and be badasses.